Evolutionary linguistics is a subfield of psycholinguistics that studies the psychosocial and cultural factors involved in the origin of language and the development of linguistic universals. The main challenge in this research is the lack of empirical data. Spoken language leaves practically no traces. This led to the abandonment of the field for more than a century, despite the common origins of language hinted at by the evolutionary relationships among individual languages established by the field of historical linguistics. Since the late 1980s, the field has been revived in the wake of progress made in the related fields of biolinguistics, psycholinguistics, neurolinguistics, evolutionary anthropology, evolutionary psychology, universal grammar, and cognitive science. Evolutionary linguistics as a field is rapidly emerging as a result of developments in neighboring disciplines. To what extent languages' features are determined by genes, a hotly debated dichotomy in linguistics, has had new light shed upon it by the discovery of the FOXP2 gene. An English family with a severe, heritable language dysfunction was found to have a defective copy of this gene. Mutations of the corresponding gene in mice FOXP2 is fairly well conserved. Modern humans share the same allele as Neanderthals, cause reductions in size and vocalization rate. If both copies are damaged, the Purkinje layer, a part of the cerebellum that contains better connected neurons than any other, develops abnormally, runting is more common, and pups die within weeks due to inadequate lung development. Additionally, higher presence of FOXP2 in songbirds is correlated to song changes, with downregulation causing incomplete and inaccurate song imitation in zebra finches. In general, evidence suggests that the protein is vital to neuroplasticity. There is little support, however, for the idea that FOXP2 is the grammar gene or that it had much to do with the relatively recent emergence of syntactical speech. Another controversial dichotomy is the question of whether human language is solely human or on a continuum with, admittedly far-removed, animal communication systems. Studies in ethology have forced researchers to reassess many claims of uniquely human abilities for language and speech. For instance, Tecumseh Fitch has argued that the descended larynx is not unique to humans. Similarly, once held uniquely human traits such as form and perception, combinatorial phonology and compositional semantics are now thought to be shared with at least some non-human animal species. Conversely, Derek Bickerton and others argue that the advent of abstract words provided a mental basis for analyzing higher-order relations, and that any communication system that remotely resembles human language utterly relies on cognitive architecture that co-evolved alongside language. As it leaves no fossils, language's form and even its presence are extremely hard or impossible to deduce from physical evidence. Computational modeling is now widely accepted as an approach to assure the internal consistency of language evolution scenarios. Approximately one-third of all papers presented at the 2010 Evolution of Language Conference rely at least in part on computer simulations. One original researcher in the field is Luke Steels, head of the research units of Sony CSL in Paris and the AI lab at the Vrije Universiteit Brussels. He and his team are currently investigating ways in which artificial agents self-organize languages with natural-like properties and how meaning can co-evolve with language. Their research is based on the hypothesis that language is a complex adaptive system that emerges through adaptive interactions between agents and continues to evolve in order to remain adapted to the needs and capabilities of the agents. This research has been implemented in fluid construction grammar (FCG), a formalism for construction grammars that has been specially designed for the origins and evolution of language. The approach of computational modeling and the use of robotic agents grounded in real life is claimed to be theory independent. It enables the researcher to find out exactly what cognitive capacities are needed for certain language phenomena to emerge. It also focuses the researcher in formulating hypotheses in a precise and exact manner, whereas theoretical models often stay very vague. Some linguists, such as John McWhorter, have analyzed the evolution and construction of basic communication methods such as pidginization and creolization. Nativist models of universal grammar are informed by linguistic universals such as the existence of pronouns and demonstratives, and the similarities in each language's process of nominalization, the process of verbs becoming nouns, as well as the reverse, the process of turning nouns into verbs. This is a purely descriptive approach to what we mean by natural language, without attempting to address its emergence. Finally, there are those archaeologists and evolutionary anthropologists, among them Ian Watts, Camilla Power and Chris Knight, co-founder with James Herford of the Evolang series of conferences, who argue that the origin of language is probably an insoluble problem. In agreement with Amat Zahavi, Knight argues that language, being a realm of patent fictions, is a theoretical impossibility in a Darwinian world, where signals must be intrinsically reliable. If we are going to explain language's evolution, according to this view, we must tackle it as part of a wider one, the evolutionary emergence of symbolic culture as such.